Pobal was established in 1992 by the Irish government and the European Union to manage a grant that addressed poverty and local development. Today we manage 22 programmes on behalf of 6 government departments. These programmes would range from local development to early education and childcare to social enterprises and labour market activation. We have staff based in a number of offices across the country, from Dublin to Sligo, Clifton to Monaghan to Cork. So we're in a position to offer local, regional and national supports to the programmes and our funders. We manage a range of programmes on behalf of government departments. In the main, the Department of Environment, Community and Local Government, the Department of Social Protection, the Department of Children and Youth Affairs, and the Department of Justice, Equality, as well as other departments and agencies. We offer a range of programme management expertise across these programmes, from the very start of the life cycle, when groups apply for funding, right through the financial management of the grants through the course of the programme, right to the very end when we look at evaluation and learning from good practice and exchange of good practice, and are in a position then to inform government departments of the lessons that are gleaned from that in terms of building new programmes for the future.
Seamus Boland is my name. I'm chairman of Pobal. The board of Pobal is 16 members, all of whom are appointed by government. Their job is effectively to manage the organisation, to hold the CEO to account, to approve of budgets, to make sure it's compliant, and effectively to keep to the aims and objectives of Pobal. The board's aim and objective are all to do with the development of the community sector, to ensure that social inclusion is protected, and to ensure that monies given to communities is spent well, equally that communities have the capacity to spend it well, and to ensure that those services which are not normally available to communities, especially vulnerable communities, are there.
Transport providers, then we step in and provide a reliable service to our members. It's a member-based organisation, and with over 7,000 or 8,000 members at this stage. In other words, if you are not on a bus route, you're not on a train route, the weather doesn't suit, or whatever, your disability doesn't suit the regular timing or conditions of the public service, transport providers, then we step in and provide a reliable service to our members. It's a member-based organisation, and with over 7,000 or 8,000 members at this stage. It was set up in the 1980s as a project under the Centre for Independent Living. Then it was very much a charitable organisation with very few funds, very little resources. Since then, it has grown to a much larger organisation with about 32 vans, 33 vans, and about 7,000 or 8,000 lifts a month. It's important for that to exist because the public service vehicles don't accommodate all our needs. Pobal is the actual agent on behalf of the Department of Social Welfare that pays our grants. They offer business support and all sorts of other supports that we need to provide the service.
My name is Deirdre McMahon and I am the manager of Kings Island Community Creche. We used to be quite a small service based within the community centre, but our demand grew for childcare places and there was a demand within the community. So hence, you know, we applied for capital funding, we got our capital funding and we've now built our new state-of-the-art service. Initially we were operating from the community centre and we had two small rooms and it wasn't sufficient, the premises just wasn't sufficient at all, particularly for the demand that we were getting from the local community that, you know, childcare was growing, families were growing, and our next step was then to, you know, move on to Pobal, and we were granted our capital funding and we got our new building. You would have families that would be, I suppose, in need of support, and that's primarily our focus, is to care for those children and look after those children, you know, and make sure they get the best care possible.
So we're one of 11 projects under national umbrella through Pobal, the National Early Years Access Initiative. So there are 11 sites nationally, 7 in Dublin and 4 outside. So it'd be Cork, Limerick, Donegal and Longford, Westmeath. The idea is that you'd have an early intervention and prevention project that was time-bound in a specific geographical or model area. So for us, that's the south side of Limerick. It's a regeneration area and we're time-bound with 30 months under our funding. So for us, we work on a two-tier system. We work intensively with parents and also with early years practitioners because they're the biggest source of influence on a child's life from day to day. If you were to take our area, our geographical area, we would have 9 early year settings and 5 primary schools. We'd work with all of the practitioners, teachers, homeschool liaisons within those to look specifically at working with children and families of birth to 6. So there'd be an intensive mentoring programme with them, also encouraging them to work through things that traditionally, again, have always been a little bit outside of what they'd see as their remit. So for example, parental engagement. If the parents are confident and happy to engage with the practitioner, there's no information lost, because I suppose that's what we see an awful lot of, is children falling between the cracks or their information falling between the cracks.
My name is Susan Walsh. I'm the Education Programme Manager here in the Ballymun White Area Partnership. Obviously the Ballymun White Area Partnership here would be funded completely by Pobal. Back in 2008, the partnership decided to do something about the poor school attendance that we actually had in Ballymun. And they led a working group of different organisational community partners in the area to decide how it actually could be approached. And it was agreed at the time that this was very much a shared problem. It wasn't just a problem that the schools were having, it was a problem that faced the entire community. So from that point of view, they came together and committed to actually doing something as a group of organisations in the community to actually improve school attendance. So we also then looked at having a school attendance promoter in each of the schools. So on a day-to-day basis, you have a attendance promoter basically checking to see whether the kids are in, and if they're not in, they will get in touch with the parents. So it's a very consistent approach and it works very, very well.
This is where our roles then, there's 10 of us in the Whitehall Ballymun area for attendance promotion, where we literally promote attendance and tell the kids, you know, if you're not in school, well then you miss out. So it's miss a day, miss out, that's the slogan. So what I do is literally go into the class, I, you know, have a bit of rapport with the kids. If they weren't in school yesterday, it's, we're delighted to have you back, we missed you, you're feeling better now. So I take the role, and then every Friday, whoever had full attendance for the week will get a sweet.
We have also made huge differences in terms of reductions in poor school attendance, which would be identified as 20 plus days absence a year, and also chronic non-attendance, which would be 51 days plus a year. So both those figures have been greatly reduced as well. So overall, the initiative has been hugely successful. It has made huge impacts, and I think it will show over time as well. Positive outcomes will lead to positive prospects for employment, for your health, for your income. So it really will have an awful lot of knock-on effects, and I think that's what's been hugely important as well about this initiative, is that it gives children in Ballymun an opportunity to be able to look forward to a better lifestyle in the future and better prospects. And that's really what it comes down to.
So I'm Kate Hammond and I'm the project coordinator with Side by Side Integration Through the Arts.
Well, I suppose Kate and Fiona came in with this exciting new project where they asked for our students, our international students, to be involved in a youth theatre group, and we said absolutely.
Its emphasis is really on intercultural dialogue, and we create intercultural dialogue. We look at intercultural issues using drama as the medium.
Our job is really not just about educating our students in front of us in the different languages or the different subject areas. It's also about creating an environment in which everybody's integrated, there's nobody alienated, to create new relationships with other people, to get on with people, to learn those kind of skills. And we're seeing that more and more. And I do think the theatre group is very important in helping students to do that. A lot of the issues students have when they come in from other countries is that they may not necessarily speak very good English, or they may have different levels of English. Some would be pre-intermediate, some might be just beginners, some would be advanced. And it's really interesting to see how they will help each other along with what they're saying, and give them confidence to say, well, okay, you may not know the word for this, or you may not be able to express yourself fully in this area, but we understand what you're trying to say. It gives them a huge amount of confidence, and it's very empowering.
When we ask the girls themselves, what do you like about youth theatre? Their number one is always making friends, make new friends.
They love it.
That's their number one reason
for
coming. We make it a very safe space where you're supported.
By actually going through that process, they actually open their minds to a whole new element of imagination and words and vocabulary. It's such a powerful medium in which to express yourself, really, isn't it?
I'm Niamh Wogan, I'm the manager of the Little Bray Family Resource and Development Centre, which is a community development project based in the Fassaroe Estate in Bray.
I'm Cathy Heffernan, and I'm the chairperson of the Board of Management of the Bray Family Resource Centre.
Well, the centre started originally back in 1986, and it was identified as a gap in the community for some place for women to meet up and share experiences and learn from each other, and developed from there, really.
So we've a range of services. They range from just anybody can drop in to get a cup of tea, get a little bit of support. We have a welfare rights information and referral service where people can get information and support around their rights and entitlements. We have an adult education programme where, one, we provide adult education basic programmes within the project, but we also support people to access mainstream education and progress into it. I suppose we've about 500 young people engaged in the youth project at any one time. We do a lot of collaboration with local agencies and other local organisations about developing initiatives for the local community, and I suppose feeding into policy making both at a local and national level. The project is supported from a number of different funding streams, many of which are administered by Pobal, I suppose. We have funding for youth and childcare, and then we also have a mix of, we have got current funding for different programmes and capital funding over the years. I suppose one of the other things that has enabled the project really to function over the last 15 years is the provision of a community employment project, which provides community employment places to local people who are unemployed. Sometimes when people are living in crisis and things are really tough, they need to just come over and have somewhere where they can be and be creative and get support and talk to each other.
Good governance means that this money is spent well, lessons are learned during the spending, plans made to develop services to the community are plans that work, are good plans, and that the board and indeed the staff take seriously their responsibilities in terms of this company.